Welcome to the first of three programs celebrating the art of Lois Marshall. Hark the Echoing Air by Henry Purcell, sung by Lois Marshall with Weldon Kilburn at the piano, a song which has been an especial delight to Lois Marshall and to her audiences throughout her long career. As I mentioned, this is the first of three programs about Lois Marshall. Today, we shall hear her in oratorio and concert music. In the next broadcast, we shall hear her in opera, and finally, in song recital. Throughout all these broadcasts, we shall have conversations with Miss Marshall herself and with many of her distinguished colleagues. My own experience of Lois Marshall began when I was a boy, and like so many others, I've been fortunate in being able to follow a career that has extended over 35 years, a career that's taken her countless times across Canada, to the United States, to Europe, to the Soviet Union, to Australia and New Zealand. Great conductors sought her out: Toscanini, Stokowski, Beecham, Ozawa, Joachim, Reiner, Munch, Zell, among many others. Whenever she sings, her success has always been more than simply that of a singer of dazzling virtuosity. The particular greatness of Lois Marshall was summed up by a reviewer in the journal Musical America when writing about a New York town hall recital in 1955. He wrote, "Unusual intelligence, style, and musicianship are hers. But most important, and it is the factor that makes her a genuine mature artist, is her power to project with great immediacy and conviction what she feels about the words and music she is singing. Singing seems as natural to her as speech to a great actor." Among all the great oratorios in which Lois Marshall has been soloist, in none has she sung more often than Handel's Messiah, and nothing could better introduce us to the art of Lois Marshall than the aria "Rejoice Greatly" from that work, with the exuberance of expression, the pure joy of singing that Miss Marshall always brings to her listeners. Here is part of that aria from a recording of Messiah made early in her career in 1952 with the Toronto Symphony Orchestra conducted by Sir Ernest Macmillan.
Rejoice, 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 rej
Marshall was born in Toronto, received her musical training in this city, and has always made it her home. As a young girl in the 1930s and early 1940s, she enjoyed the warmth and stimulation of a musical family and the support of musical sisters.
They all had lovely voices. I don't just mean pretty voices. They had excellent voices. They didn't commit themselves to that. I had one sister in particular, though, who used to take me to concerts as a young child. And I heard people like Heifetz and Horowitz when they were very young. And we used to go to summer concerts. You wouldn't remember them. But they were summer symphony concerts at Varsity Arena. And we used to go to those regularly. And she was wonderful to me because she first got me, you know, my first great artists I saw and heard with her.
There was also Fred Marshall, a vocally talented brother.
He was the oldest in the family, is still. So he brought a lot of music into the house, and we had all his recordings. And he certainly took singing very seriously and studied and was planning to do something with it. But then the war came along, and he wasn't quite the same after that. He went into business.
I asked Lois Marshall how, in a musical family, one member in particular emerges as a special singer.
I really don't know. Maybe it's self-preservation. I mean, there's so much opposition, you know. We often laugh about it now because I had a terrible time trying to find a place to practice or even to practice at all. You know, because my mother would hear these complaints. Mom, do we have to listen to her? You can hear her all the way down to the corner, and it's so embarrassing.
When only 2 years old, she contracted polio, a disease which left her with a walking disability, but already in those days she was literally singing.
Yes, especially in the sick children's hospital, where I spent a lot of time between age 2 and age 12. People wanted to hear me, I guess. It must have been that, because I wouldn't have just sung. I mean, I might have sung if I was by myself, but I wouldn't sing in a room with other people unless someone wanted me to. And even when they wanted me to, I didn't want to. But then I usually did.
At the age of 12, Lois Marshall began serious vocal study with Weldon Kilburn at the Conservatory in Toronto. Kilburn was not simply a voice teacher, but also a fine pianist and organist, the kind of rounded musician who could help Lois Marshall develop more than merely a vocal technique. Weldon Kilburn remembers those early years with his young student and his own realization of her great talent.
I found that she didn't have any, I didn't feel any communication. I couldn't seem to elicit any real response. She clammed up in the studio rather badly. In fact, badly. And it was only when I had a young student about the same age who was a pianist, and I decided to let her do a recital. And for some reason, I thought, well, I'll just see what Lois might be able to do, and I let her sing one group of songs on the recital. At any rate, she did the show, when she got in front of the audience, suddenly she just captured them. It was extraordinary. And I realized then, of course, that I had a sort of bomb on my hands, you know. It was the audience, you see. And after that, of course, there wasn't that much trouble, because she knew that I had found her out, I guess. I think she was just very, very shy.
By the mid-1940s, people were beginning to take note of the young soprano of phenomenal ability, not only because of the brilliance and security of her vocal technique, but especially because of a communicative ability which was so compelling in her singing. Greta Kraus, who in more recent years would be a pianist for Lois Marshall's leader recitals, was in those earlier days a harpsichordist in Toronto. Greta Kraus remembers her first meeting with Lois Marshall.
I think that the very first time I heard her sing was at a rehearsal which we held at our house. Mazzolini conducted a concert at the conservatory with the, probably, conservatory orchestra. I don't remember that. I know that I played the D minor Bach concerto. And Lois Marshall, to me until then, unknown really, was engaged to sing a cantata, an Italian cantata, in which I played the continuo. And she came to the house, and I see her still leaning on the piano, close to my harpsichord and starting to sing, and it was unbelievable, the effect. I was absolutely stunned. It was so different from anything I'd ever heard. The intensity, the musicality, the sincerity, a young girl. It was not of this world. I can't really quite explain it.
Among those who began to take note of Lois Marshall was Sir Ernest McMillan, conductor of the Toronto Symphony Orchestra and the Toronto Mendelssohn Choir. McMillan had for some years given annual and moving performances of Bach's St. Matthew Passion, and in 1947 he invited Lois Marshall, she had just turned 23, to be soprano soloist. Greta Krause was harpsichordist for those performances under McMillan, and she recalls the first rehearsal.
She sang for the first time, and the whole orchestra was really speechless. Nobody had ever heard anything quite like it. I mean, you could not hear Lois for 5 minutes without realizing that this was a tremendous personality, talent, really somebody extraordinary.
Lois Marshall singing Jesus Savior, I Am Thine from Bach's St. Matthew Passion. The conductor was Sir Ernest McMillan, and the harpsichordist on that recording, made in 1953, was Greta Krause. The composers of the music we have heard so far, Purcell, Handel, and Bach, along with Mozart, were the foundations on which Lois Marshall built her musical art. Teacher and accompanist Weldon Kilburn talks of the importance of those composers.
I almost felt that the basis for any good performance, I guess you could almost say on any instrument, but certainly in singing, was, perhaps, Bach, Handel, Mozart, and Purcell, this kind of thing. And this is what I kept her at all the time, so that she would get a clean etching of the notes, and also to be able to plumb the remarkable depths of feeling in these works.
A sharp ear and a quickness of musical sensibility bordering originally on mimicry were also part of Lois Marshall's natural abilities.
She was, of course, she was so quick to pick things up, you know. She had an incredible ear. And the nuance that she could catch, she'd listen, for instance, I remember her hearing Peter Pears, I think, sing some of Benjamin Britten's folk songs, you know. And she listened to those quite a lot because she loved them so much. And then she was singing them herself. She sounded like a female Peter Pears. She did every darn thing he did. And gradually she took on her own perspective a little bit more. But at first, it definitely was an imitation, there's no doubt about it.
In 1950, Lois Marshall graduated from the Senior School of the Royal Conservatory of Music in Toronto with the Artist Diploma and with the Eaton Scholarship for the Outstanding Graduate. In the same year, she won the CBC radio competition Singing Stars of Tomorrow, and she also made her first major appearance outside Canada at Washington, D.C. That first step towards an international career was consolidated when she won the prestigious Naumburg competition in the United States, the award of which was a New York debut at Town Hall on December 2nd, 1952. Her pianist on that occasion, as so often over the years, was Weldon Kilburn.
It was an afternoon show, but I think there'd been a snowfall that day. I think there was a bad storm, so there wasn't really a very big crowd. But they waxed into being a very enthusiastic crowd, and of course the papers the next day just went right overboard. They just said they'd never heard anything like it.
The New York Times began its review of the recital with a comment, "The Walter W. Naumburg Musical Foundation presented yesterday afternoon at Town Hall an extraordinarily gifted soprano in the person of Lois Marshall." The reviewer went on to compare Miss Marshall's voice with voices now heard only on recordings of singers from the Golden Age and concluded that she has started a long and distinguished singing career. The Times reviewer could hardly have anticipated the rocket propulsion with which that long and distinguished career was about to take off. Shortly after the New York debut, the legendary conductor, Arturo Toscanini, asked her to audition for him. He sat at the back of the small Carnegie Recital Hall. Lois Marshall sang the Laudamus Te from Mozart's C minor Mass. Toscanini said, "Brava." She sang Et Incarnatus Est, and Toscanini said, "Bravissima." Nevertheless, Lois Marshall could only think about getting away.
The funniest thing about that was that I was told later that he wanted to see me and he wanted to meet me and so on and so on. But I wanted to get away from that place so much. And Weldon Kilburn was with me, he played for me. And we got out of that hall and we took the first plane home because it was such a terrible experience. Auditioning is a horrible, horrible business. But we left, and we just left the hall, and when he wanted to see me, I had already gone. I just didn't think I'd sung well, or I didn't think anything was, you know, I thought it was had all gone badly, I think so. And when I got home, when we arrived home, there was a telegram for me saying that the maestro wanted me to do this concert and to make the recording. I can't describe my feelings, you know, it was incredible. Unbelievable to happen to me at that time. I was just starting out in my career.
Only 4 months after the Naumburg Awards Town Hall debut recital, Lois Marshall was soloist at Carnegie Hall under Arturo Toscanini in what was to be the maestro's last performance of Beethoven's Missa Solemnis on March 28, 1953. The concert debut was preceded by an almost equally spectacular entrance by Miss Marshall into New York City for the first big orchestral rehearsal. Toscanini was not to be kept waiting.
I had been singing in Toronto the night before, and I had to fly to New York on the morning of the rehearsal, and I think the rehearsal was for 10 o'clock. And we got over LaGuardia Airport and started that circling business, which was horrible, and it went on and on and on and on, and time was going. And finally, we came down, and we landed, and when we got to the terminal, there was a New York police escort, and they whisked me away from the plane and into this car, and we just shrieked through the city of New York, and before I knew where I was, I was standing on the stage of Carnegie Hall and, ready to sing the Kyrie.
Before the rehearsals with orchestra and chorus, Toscanini had already had studio rehearsals with the soloists.
Well, that was very interesting because we had a whole week of private rehearsals, the solo quartet with Toscanini, we just with a piano accompanist. And he took fantastic pains with us to get all the voices blending and the vocal lines just going where he wanted them to. It was very hard work, but it was wonderful. We had a wonderful ensemble.
For the ensemble, one of the loveliest and I'm sure most demanding parts in that, Mrs. Aleminas, is the Benedictus towards the end, in which the soprano especially has torturous things, but
yes,
quite marvelous things,
yes,
to sing.
Terrifying, really terrifying. Every time I had to do that, I prayed to whatever gods may be to get me through it. I was never sure whether I could make it. It was so difficult.
What's difficult about it?
Well, the tessitura really is incredible. It's taxing, never comes down. It just keeps building in intensity, and you keep going up and up and up.
At one of the full rehearsals, Lois Marshall was witness to a remarkable episode illustrating Toscanini's complete absorption in the music.
We had had a break, and everyone left the stage. The choir left the stage, the orchestra, and the other soloists left. I stayed on, and the maestro was sitting down on the podium, sort of with his head down on his lap or his arm, and he seemed to be thinking about something. And they said, I asked him from the booth if he'd like to hear a playback of what we had just recorded. And he nodded that he would. And So they proceeded to play it, and he was listening, and he had his head bowed, and little by little, he started to move his arms and his head, and then he sort of slowly got up, and he stepped up on the podium, and then he faced the what should have been the choir, and started conducting madly, as though everyone was there in place. And the performance was happening.
Although the hall was completely empty at that point.
Yes.
But he was so engaged by the idea of the music.
Yes, he was so carried away with the music. I think he just thought it was all there. It was, I don't know, it was a strange and sort of awesome thing to see. His power and strength was devastating.
An excerpt from the Benedictus of Beethoven's Missa Solemnis with the NBC Symphony Orchestra conducted by Arturo Toscanini with soloist Lois Marshall, Nan Merriman, Eugene Conley, and Jerome Hines, and the Robert Shaw Chorale. Whatever terrors Miss Marshall might have felt about the demands of that passage, she clearly surmounted them with apparent ease. The spring concert with Toscanini was followed in the fall of 1953 with another appearance at Carnegie Hall, this time with Leopold Stokowski, in a concert Stokowski presented of music by Canadian composers. For the occasion, Godfrey Rideout wrote his setting of texts by John Donne, the Cantiones Mysticae, for Lois Marshall. Now, many singers, not excepting Lois Marshall, have inspired composers by the general quality of their voices. But in this case, all it took was one note.
Weldon Kilburn said that Lois had a wonderful B-flat and I should use it. So I went through the sonnet and found that I could work in a B-flat on the word God. So I wrote down B-flat and wrote God underneath it. And from there on, I worked forwards and backwards from that one note till I finished the song.
Thank you.
At the Round Earth's Imagined Corners, from the Cantioni's Mysticae by Godfrey Rideout, sung by Lois Marshall, with Leopold Stokowski conducting. There is a quality of, for want of a better word, spirituality in Lois Marshall's singing. Godfrey Rideout also worked with Lois Marshall as a conductor, and I asked him if he had experienced that quality as a performer.
Oh, yes, and I found it once particularly in 1957, when I conducted the CBC Symphony and a choir, and we did an Elgar Memorial Concert to celebrate his 100th birthday. And we did large chunks of The Kingdom, and Lois sang the role of Mary. And when she came to The Sun Goeth Down, the place just caught on fire. It was magnificent. I suppose, for want of a better word, the spirituality there was glowing. It was one of the most wonderful experiences. I mean, we all were in tune with each other. In point of fact, one person said that all the soloists caught on from Lois, and it turned out that I had a quartet of four Lois Marshalls as far as spirituality was concerned. It was contagious.
She communicates to her fellow artists as much as
indeed,
to the audience.
Oh, indeed, yes. It's interesting to note that shortly after she did that, she was engaged by Malcolm Sargent to The Apostles of Elgar.
By the time Lois Marshall sang Elgar's The Apostles with Sir Malcolm Sargent, she was already well known in England, where she had been introduced by Sir Thomas Beecham. The connection with Beecham was made via the United States. As I mentioned earlier, Miss Marshall first sang in Washington in 1950, and she was to be a regular visitor to that city over the years. One of her greatest admirers was the music critic for the Washington Post, Paul Hume, who was on good terms with Beecham. When Beecham said that he was looking for a soprano for some recordings, Hume suggested Lois Marshall. Beecham heard her in Toronto and engaged her, but Lois Marshall recounts that after the audition, Sir Thomas had a narrow escape he never knew about.
I had had my driver's license for exactly one day, and this was before England, of course, and I auditioned for him in Toronto in a big church downtown. And he was staying at the King Edward Hotel. When the audition was finished, they said, would I mind driving Sir Thomas down to his hotel? And I can assure you that the singing was nothing compared to driving him. I was so terrified. And to have to drive right into the heart of downtown, which I had never done.
Presumably Sir Thomas never learned of this.
He didn't know. He was blissfully unaware.
The first collaboration with Beecham was a recording of Handel's Solomon, released in 1956, for which Lois Marshall sang the part of the Queen of Sheba. The Air of the Queen of Sheba, When the Sun, from Solomon, by Handel. Solomon, the collaboration with Beecham, was one of the most successful of Lois Marshall's recordings and remains in the catalogs. There was also a recording with Beecham of Mozart's opera, The Abduction from the Seraglio, and another English recording, now very rare, of opera arias, both of which we shall sample on the next program in this series. A companion to the opera arias was a disc of oratorio arias, among them the famous and brilliantly taxing Let the Bright Seraphim from Handel's Samson. Handel's Let the Bright Seraphim, sung by Lois Marshall, with the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Anthony Bernard. In 1958, yet another important recording appeared, this time of Bach's Mass in B minor, with the Bavarian Radio Orchestra under Eugen Jochum. The duet Domine Deus, for soprano and tenor, is one of those ornately flowing vocal pieces of Bach where phrases extend as if composed for angelic singers who never have to breathe. The tenor soloist for this recording was Peter Peers, and Marshall and Peers are the perfect match for each other in sound, as they are in their easy ability to encompass Bach's mellifluous praise of Lord God, King of Heaven, God the Father Almighty. Peers was a singer whom Lois Marshall had long admired for qualities which might well describe her own singing.
I really adored him, and I learned so much from listening to him. It wasn't just his voice, it was the other thing that he had. I really can't put it into words. It was an expression. I've never heard anyone else sing that way and say so much as he did. He absolutely satisfied me. What I was longing for, I heard from him.
Thank you.
That was part of the duet Domini Deus from the B minor Mass by Bach, sung by Peter Peers and Lois Marshall, with the Bavarian Radio Orchestra conducted by Eugen Jochum. Much of the music we have been listening to has been from the great works of Bach and Handel, but Lois Marshall's repertoire has also included such varied works as Benjamin Britten's War Requiem, Strauss's Four Last Songs, Mahler's Fourth Symphony, Berlioz's Les Nuits d'Été, and Ravel's Scheherazade. The Ravel songs, a setting of three exotic texts conjuring up the oriental world of Scheherazade, call for quite a different kind of singing than we've been listening to. Yet Lois Marshall could so color her voice to the rich and sensual demands of Ravel's music that, as always, she is completely at one with the luminous and ecstatic quality of the songs. Here is the second song, La Flûte Enchantée, The Enchanted Flute. La Flûte Enchantée from Ravel's Scheherazade, from a performance given at Royal Festival Hall in London with the Toronto Symphony Orchestra on tour, conducted by Seiji Ozawa. Today we have been listening to one aspect of Lois Marshall's career, her many performances in concert and oratorio. Next Sunday morning we will hear Lois Marshall in operatic arias. The Echoing Air, sung by Lois Marshall with Weldon Kilburn at the piano. That song is from The Faerie Queene, an English opera by Henry Purcell, and it's opera that's the subject of this second program about Lois Marshall. A walking disability stemming from childhood polio was to limit her stage appearances, but by voice and temperament, Lois Marshall was very much a dramatic singer. She often included marvelous performances of individual arias on her concerts and recitals, but over a long career, she sang only a few complete operatic roles, and I wondered if there were others she would have liked to have sung.
Well, I think there were lots, lots and lots of them. I, of course, knew in the early days that I could not plan to have a career in opera because of my disability. It certainly saddened me, but I had so much other work to do. I was always just filled with that. But I would have liked to have done any of the great roles, soprano roles, that would suit me.
That excerpt from Tace la notte placida from Verdi's Il Trovatore is from an English recording of opera arias made by Lois Marshall in 1959, a recording now very rare, and we'll hear more from it later in today's program. Lois Marshall's involvement with opera extends from the very beginning of her career right up to the moment. I didn't know how early that career had included opera until composer Godfrey Rideout drew out of his memory something that was a surprise to me when I asked him when he first became aware of Lois Marshall.
I think when I went to a matinee performance of Princess Ida given by the Eton Operatic Society, and she was singing Ida. Despite the fact that she was lame, you never noticed that on the stage at all. They had geared the stage action to her, but her singing was absolutely marvelous. And when she came to the aria, I Built Upon a Rock, she had to sing it three times. It was really wonderful.
Just as Godfrey Rideout surprised me with that reference to the Eton Operatic Society, I in turn was able to surprise Lois Marshall with that unexpected recollection of her first important public appearance in 1945 on the operatic stage in the title role of Gilbert and Sullivan's Princess Ida.
That's right, yes. Oh, goodness. That was in the days when I was not a secretary, a typist and an office person. And I worked for the T. Eaton Company. That was, oh my God, I can't remember how long ago. But this, I was supposed to, be paying for my singing lessons with this job. And then I heard about the Eton Operatic Society, and so I joined it. And they were doing Princess Ida that year. So after I got into the company, they asked me to understudy the role. And I did that, and then they said, well, I should really do a performance, so I did. I think I did two performances of it. But, that was the sort of thing that I knew the whole role before they ever asked me to do it. I mean, I knew it from cover to cover. Those, you know how you learn things in those days.
I think you learned everything from cover to cover, didn't you?
Well, just about. Everything I had to do, I knew it backwards and forwards, practically.
Did you like doing Gilbert and Sullivan?
Well, that's actually, aside from doing arias, you know, here and there, that was the only full role I ever did. Mm-hmm. That was a wonderful role to sing. Absolutely lovely. I mean, it was almost like grand opera.
Do you still remember it?
Yes. I built upon a rock, and the lovely trio, oh, Dainty Violet, or Little Triolet, something like that. And
music from Princess Ida, the work in which Lois Marshall first appeared on the operatic stage. It was 3 years after that production of Princess Ida that I first heard Lois Marshall, and I'll never forget it. I was only 13 at the time, and the occasion was an end-of-year concert given by the Conservatory in Toronto at Massey Hall, at which the performers were the Conservatory Orchestra and outstanding student soloists. Lois Marshall sang the wildly difficult aria Martin aller Arten from Mozart's opera The Abduction from the Seraglio, and I was dazzled. My musical frame of reference at the time was small, but I knew unmistakably that I was at an event. And it wasn't just youthful inexperience on my part. There were others at Massey Hall that May night in 1948 who were equally dazzled, including Sir Ernest Macmillan, conductor of the Toronto Symphony Orchestra, and Godfrey Rideout, who remembers the evening as vividly as I do.
It was absolutely magnificent. Sir Ernest said it was the finest singing he'd ever heard in Massey Hall.
Constanza, the heroine of The Abduction from the Seraglio, has been captured by the Pasha Salim, who tries to force her acquiescence to him with threats of torture. She confronts him with an aria that mixes fiery defiance with a tender appeal for heaven's mercy. Lois Marshall recorded the role of Constanza with Sir Thomas Beecham in 1956, and it's part of that recording we're hearing now. During the recording period, Beecham also introduced Lois Marshall to London audiences, and at that debut pulled a typically Beecham trick. She was to sing Mozart's Exultate Jubilate on the concert, a piece that showed her off effectively, but just before the performance, Sir Thomas made a suggestion to Miss Marshall that would have given a lesser singer heart failure.
I did the Constanza's great aria, Martin aller Arten, as an encore. Yes.
That must be one of the most spectacular encores anyone's ever sung.
And he assured me not, he said, well, we didn't rehearse it. Of course we were recording, you know, so it was fresh in your mind. But he said, of course you can't be for the audience. The Martin encore, maybe not, but we had one of these Constanza's. And I said, well,
should we translate
that?
Do you
mean uncut? He said, of course.
So really, without any warning, he expected you just to sing Martin aller Arten as an
But it was really wonderful to do it because, you know, it gave me a lot of scope. And the Exultate did not. So it was a great idea.
How did the audience respond?
Oh, that was fantastic.
I bet they were as surprised as you were.
Yes. It was. I mean, it was a very nice reception for the Exultate, but after that big aria, it was wonderful.
Thank you. A portion of the great aria Martin aller Arten from Mozart's The Abduction from the Seraglio, sung by Lois Marshall with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra conducted by Sir Thomas Beecham. The recording with Beecham was the only complete operatic role recorded by Lois Marshall, and teacher and accompanist Weldon Kilburn recalls the audition with Beecham that led to it.
Apparently he had heard of Lois, and he wanted to have her do an audition for the Mozart Seraglio, and Beecham said that he'd been waiting for 35 years, this is what he said, to find a soprano who could sing that role. So anyway, he came, he wrote us here in Toronto, and we did an aria from the Seraglio, and Beecham was just floored by it. He thought she was fantastic.
Normally, the preparation of an opera includes rehearsals with soloists with piano before the main rehearsals with orchestra. But Sir Thomas Beecham was notoriously easygoing in his attitude towards rehearsal, and I was curious to know if, preceding the recording of Seraglio, there had been separate preparation by Beecham with the soloists.
There wasn't. He didn't rehearse. We didn't have a piano rehearsal, ever, ever. And I think we were a little concerned for the big ensemble numbers in the opera. And we asked, at one point I remember, we asked Lady Beecham, she was always there, of course, whether Sir Thomas would agree that we should have a piano rehearsal. And she said, "Oh, no, you don't need a piano rehearsal. You need only to come down to the rehearsal and listen to the orchestra, and then you'll record. That's all the rehearsal you need. That's all the rehearsal we got." And we had not sung together, any of us, before.
It's amazing, because the recording
really is
absolutely a wonder.
When I hear it, I think, there it is. And you know, we were total strangers to each other.
Yeah.
The conclusion of the second act of Mozart's Abduction from the Seraglio, sung spontaneously and unrehearsed by Lois Marshall, Leopold Simenon, Ilse Hollweg, and Gerhard Unger, with the Royal Philharmonic conducted by Sir Thomas Beecham. Before that 1956 recording, another Mozart opera had already played an important part in Lois Marshall's career. While she was still a student at the Royal Conservatory in Toronto, the CBC Opera Company was formed. The producer was Terence Gibbs, and conductor was Nicholas Goldschmidt. The first season was in 1949, and Lois Marshall sang her first serious operatic role, the dramatic part of Donna Anna in Mozart's Don Giovanni, which she repeated with the company in 1950. Although he had observed Lois Marshall as a student, it was at a CBC concert which he conducted that Nicholas Goldschmidt first recognized the young singer's dramatic potential.
The thing which really struck me as extraordinary was when I did a C minor mass of Mozart for the CBC in 1948, and Lois sang the soprano part, and from then on all of us knew that there was a talent of incredible not only size but depth and charm and everything. Her musicianship radiated far beyond a microphone or wherever. I mean, she was and is today, as everyone knows, when she gets on the stage, her personality, her musicianship, her voice, her expression, all goes over the footlights, and that's the secret of success. I had always an enormous admiration for her, because also as a human being, you know, that is so important. If you as a human being can project what you feel and what you are and what you present, that goes also over the footlights, and that was the quality and is the quality of Lois. That's there, you sympathize right away with the character she presents. It's so clear and so poignant, I would say. So when the CBC Opera Company was formed, the so-called CBC Opera Company was a very loose organization. However, it started, and Terence Gibbs was the producer, and Hermann Geiger Torelli, I think, was advisor. And when Don Giovanni was chosen, who else could sing at that time Donna Anna? No one else but Lois Marshall. Unbelievable. I'm absolutely flabbergasted. I haven't heard this since it was performed. But the thing which, now that I hear it, which really startles me, it's better than 90%, 95% of all the singers who hear now. It's better because it's clear. There's no scooping up to the high A and the tachitura. Remarkable.
Well, I think it's not only remarkable just as singing, but imagine that such a young singer, in her first operatic experiences, should sing Donna Anna of all roles, and so magnificently.
Well, I would say that is typical. You see, when Lois takes something on, she takes it on with a determination. Yes, I can do it, therefore I'll do it. She would never take anything on where she wouldn't be completely sure that she can deliver the goods.
What other experiences did you have with her operatic career?
Quite a number. One of the things perhaps very few people know is that she sang the Queen of the Night at the Royal Alexandra Theatre when we had the, I think it was called the Opera Festival Association.
Yes, I remember hearing that.
Yes, and that example, again, there was no one. You see, there are all kind of coloratura singers, which is the great mistake most people make when they cast the Queen of the Night just with a coloratura singer, because the lower range has to be heard. And the Queen of the Night is a dramatic coloratura who has to really have the full voice apart from the high F. Well, she had both. And she was absolutely a sensation.
That performance of Don Giovanni by the CBC Opera Company, conducted by Nicholas Goldschmidt, from which we heard part of the aria Orsai che l'onore a moment ago, was broadcast in the spring of 1950. The fall season was to begin with Beethoven's Fidelio. The role of the heroine, Leonora, is a demanding one, requiring sustained and heroic singing, quite different from the coloratura requirements of Constanze, as we heard earlier today. It would be a remarkable achievement for a singer to encompass Constanze, Donna Anna, and Leonora within a single career, never mind all at the same time. But the strength of the voice, combined with astonishing flexibility, enabled Lois Marshall to do just that. And the circumstances under which she added Beethoven's Leonora to her repertoire make it even more amazing. Nicholas Goldschmidt.
Louis Roy was cast to sing Leonora. But Louis Roy fell ill about 5 days before we went on the air. The orchestra rehearsals had already started. And I said to Terence Gibbs that time, I said, well, I don't know who can sing it. The only possibility might be if Lois steps in. It's the only one I can think of. I said, why don't you try? I said, well, we can try, but I don't promise anything. So I was, you know, remember the old conservatory on College Street, and there was a sofa in the hall. And there was Lois sitting with a book. And I said, what are you doing? I said, I'm studying a Bach cantata. You know, she always studied the music, even without a piano, and she had an incredible memory and everything. I said, I want you to do something for me. I said, what's that? I said, why don't you go to the library and pick up the score of Fidelio? Have you ever sung Fidelio? I said, no. I said, well, there's a pretty good aria in there. Abscheuliche, wo eilst du hin, the big aria. And so I said, why don't you look at it and tell me if you might be able to sing it for us in 5 days, we have the broadcast. She said, are you nuts? She didn't say that way, but I saw it on her face. I said, no, I have great confidence in you. So she picked up the score, and I said, when you are ready, come perhaps tomorrow and read it through with me. And there she came. And it was one of those things which you couldn't believe it could happen. There she was, and she sang that absolutely magnificently. So I telephoned to Terence. I think if she can learn it in a few days, she could do it magnificently. And that's what happened. And within 5 days, she learned the whole part.
The last part of the aria Abscheulicher, wo eilst du hin, from Beethoven's Fidelio, Lois Marshall with the orchestra of the CBC Opera Company, conducted by Nicholas Goldschmidt, from a 1950 radio broadcast. Another example from the romantic German repertoire that Miss Marshall frequently sang in concert is a scene from Weber's Der Freischütz, in which the heroine, Agatha, waits expectantly for the arrival of her lover. Lois Marshall recorded the scene in 1959 on the same disc as the Trovatore excerpt which began today's program, and it is the perfect example of acting with the voice. Agatha listens to the rustling sounds of the evening forest, waiting the approach of her lover. She hears him, and the exclamation, er ist's, it's him, it's him, is delivered by Marshall with such joy and urgency and expectancy. And her excitement grows to a rapturous conclusion as her pulse quickens, her heart beats faster, and she thanks heaven that her hope is realized. last part of the scene, Liza Liza, from Weber's Der Freischütz, Lois Marshall was accompanied by the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Eduardo Pedrazzoli. Lois Marshall's voice has never really fitted the conventional categories of voice types. I've heard her sing a coloratura aria, such as Martin Allerarten, which we heard earlier, and follow it with Alla from Wagner's Tannhäuser, two arias on opposite ends of the soprano spec, and there were other arias, such as the Jewel Song from Faust, the arias from Puccini's Manon Lescaut, Return of Incita Aida, Dura, lyric and dramatic soprano, and evil soprano. If this demonstrates all of these aspects, it's Come Scoglio from Mozart, but much of the music is sung in the lower part of the voice. In 1965, Seiji Ozawa took the Toronto Symphony Orchestra on tour to Great Britain and Europe, and soloist on that tour. On last week's program, we heard part of Lois Marshall's performance with the orchestra in London of Ravel's richly exotic Scheherazade. I doubt if few other singers could have given so marvelous a performance of those mezzo-soprano songs and then sung an encore like this.
Thank you.
Other have been performances on two separate occasions of the title role in Massenet's Thérèse for opera in concert in Toronto, and a lovely portrayal of the nurse in the Toronto Symphony Orchestra's presentation in 1980 of Tchaikovsky's Eugene Onegin, a role that Lois Marshall will repeat on stage this summer at the 1983 Festival Ottawa. Could we possibly hope that in the future we might yet hear her in another Tchaikovsky opera that would suit her so very well, The Queen of Spades? At any rate, there have been a number of major opera performances by Lois Marshall, but I asked Stuart Hamilton, for some years now minist and also the director of opera in concert in Toronto, if he thought we lost out on other wonderful operatic portrayals.
Lisa was handicapped at a very early age. She had polio when she was two, and she's always had difficulty walking. And I don't think this...
Oh, yes,
who was a very great leader teacher at the beginning of my time in Toronto, and Lois studied with her as well, and Lois adored Emmy and learned a great deal from her, I think, as far as her interpretation of leader was concerned. But Emmy, Lois did Ellen Orford when they did the television version of Peter Grimes here on the CBC, and everybody was surprised at what a good actress she was. And Emmy said, why should they be surprised? You could tell that from the way she sings leader, that she's a great actress.
I want to conclude today with excerpts from two roles, Norma and Turandot, that I, for one, would have loved to have heard Lois Marshall sing. They are roles from quite different parts of the soprano spectrum, but equally suited to the Marshall voice. They do share a temperamental similarity and strong defiance, affectingly is able to express in her singing. The part of Norma requires a rich but lyrical sound and delicacy and fluent singing. An excerpt from Casta Diva from Norma with the London Symphony Orchestra conducted by Eduardo Pedrazzoli. A portion of the lyrically beautiful Casta Diva from Norma, sung by Lois Marshall. I once heard Lois Marshall sing In Questa Regia from Turandot, and the role of Turandot since then has always been for me a made-to-order role for Lois Marshall. She had the power, the soaring intensity for the role of the indomitable princess. Turandot remembers the defeat of her distant ancestor, also a princess, at the hands of a man, and she will submit to no one, not even the unknown prince. In Questa Regia. In Questa Regia, from Puccini's Turandot, sung by Lois Marshall with the Pedrazzoli. We've been listening to the aspect of Lois Marshall's career which has perhaps been the least known. Next week, on our final program, we'll hear Lois Marshall as she has been best known in Canada as around the world, celebrating the art of Lois Marshall. Hark the Echoing Air, sung by Lois Marshall with pianist Weldon Kilburn. Her song by Purcell must easily be one of the songs Lois Marshall has sung most often on song recitals around the world. On our two earlier broadcasts, we heard Miss Marshall in concert and oratorio, and her in the repertoire for which perhaps most people best know her, the song with piano accompaniment. Following her winning of the Eaton Award as the most outstanding graduate of the Royal Conservatory in Toronto in 1950, Lois Marshall made her solo debut with a recital at Eaton Auditorium in Toronto, and it was a song recital that launched her international career in 1952, when the prestigious Naumburg Foundation in the United States awarded her the prize of a recital at Town Hall in New York. During the 30 years following those debut recitals, Lois Marshall has given countless recitals across Canada and around the world. We want on today's program to give you some idea of the extent of her musical travels and the repertoire that figured so prominently in her many recitals. One of the countries most often visited by Lois Marshall was the Netherlands, and one of the song cycles she's most often performed was the 7 popular songs of Manuel de Falla. As it happens, we can combine the two through the courtesy of the Netherlands Radio, which has made available to us a recital broadcast by Miss Marshall in the Netherlands in 1956. Here is one of those 7 popular songs, Polo, a passionate cry of the pain of disappointed love. The pianist is the Dutch pianist George van Renesse. From the 7 popular songs of Manuel de Falla, sung by Lois Marshall with pianist George van Renesse. That song shows off the particularly rich quality of Lois Marshall's low voice, a quality I've remarked on before during these broadcasts. There's another example of this dark sound on this same 1956 Netherlands recital, this time not passionate but lyrical. Here's the 3rd of Brahms's 4 serious songs, O Tod, wie bitter bist du, O Death, How bitter art thou to the man who dwelleth in peace. O Tot, wie bitter bist du, from the four serious songs of Brahms, sung by Lois Marshall with George von Renesse at the piano. It's impossible to guess how many young singers Lois Marshall must have inspired by example, but at least one other great singer remembers the effect a Marshall recital had on her. Dutch soprano Ellie Ameling, herself now one of the world's great recitalists, spoke with me after her Toronto concert this season and recalls the first time she heard Lois Marshall, Ellie Ameling.
It was indeed when I was still in school and beginning my studies that we had all those beautiful singers in a small but very elegant recital hall in The Hague. And this hall was called Diligentia. And we had people like Suze and Dieskau and Kathleen Ferrier and Peter Piers and Victoria de Los Angeles Schwarzkopf and Lois Marshall. They were all in their prime. And I remember Lois sang Frauenliebe und Leben. And right from the first tone, she, let me say, she imprinted something of soul quality in my little young girl's mind. And I think those are very important experiences, what you get in the beginning of your life, first as a child and then certainly as a young student. And the she had that warm, embracing personality, I would say, when she sang and when she shone, when her soul shone out of her, radiated, huh? And I'll never forget that. And I think it is, it has helped to build me up. Yeah, and how the people in The Hague, the audience, loved her. Oh, yes, she returned year after year in those days. Oh, yes.
I was thinking at your recent recital that there is a kind of directness and simplicity in your own singing and a kind of involvement, which is clearly you, but I couldn't help but wonder whether or not some notion of that possibility had perhaps been won by you from that early experience.
Oh, yes, I'm absolutely sure of that. She had that same, as you call it, directness and warmth of somebody like Kathleen Ferrier, who had that also very much.
Do you think there's particular qualities in Marshall's singing which are perhaps really distinctive, not perhaps true of singers at large, even great singers?
Well, I surely think, here again, I come always with her voice back to this warmth of the heart and the outpouring of feelings first, and then the quality of the voice. It's a very lovely, round voice. Absolutely.
Something that's not learned, really.
No, you have that. You're born. It's a God-given thing, of course. And I think nowadays people are, well, not all of them, but many people are out for the big, brilliant sound of the opera stage. There's nothing against that. But a moment of intimacy, as she can give, is something very, very to be treasured, very much to be treasured.
Rheinlegenden by Gustav Mahler, from a 1956 recital for Netherlands Radio, sung by Lois Marshall with pianist George van Renesse. In 1958, Lois Marshall made the first of 8 tours of the Soviet Union. She was among the first musicians to visit there after the many years of isolation between the East and West. Her accompanist, as on so many important occasions, was Weldon Kilburn. And Mr. Kilburn and Miss Marshall both recount the thrill of the first concert in Moscow in 1958 and the successes which followed.
The first Moscow concert, the hall was maybe 2/3 full. They didn't know who we were. But at any rate, we started off doing our usual sort of thing. And the applause became a little bit more exuberant as time went on. But at any rate, by the time the concert was over, the crowd just came right out of the seats, right up to the stage. And you'd see these people with tears running down their cheeks and smiling faces, of course, and hands all stretched out. They wanted us to just take their hands. And they kept on insisting on encores. I can't tell you how many we did. We learned a little better after a while, but I'll bet you we did about 20 encores in that first concert. Just went on and on and on, and of course after that concert they said, well, when you're through the rest of the tour, you must come back to Moscow and do another one, which we did.
And ever after that, you couldn't get a seat at one of our concerts for anything. They had people everywhere, including always on stage. Then they'd always come with little bouquets of flowers and or little books or picture and lay them on the platform. It was so moving.
Two recordings of performances by Lois Marshall and Weldon Kilburn were issued in the Soviet Union, recordings made there during the tours. One of them includes the work earlier mentioned by Ellie Ameling, Schumann's song cycle Frauenliebe und Leben, Woman's Love and Life, a cycle frequently sung by Miss Marshall throughout her career. Here is one song from that cycle, sung during one of the Russian tours, Du Ring an meinem Finger, a song to the ring on her finger, the symbol of the woman's transfiguring love.
Du bist erst bei dir, hast meinen Weg.
Du Ring an meinem Finger, from the cycle Frauenliebe und Leben by Schumann, from a Russian recording made by Lois Marshall and pianist Weldon Kilburn. I think a subject of endless fascination is how an artist absorbs those cryptic marks that composers put on a page, how performers take the messages of printed music into their bloodstreams and turn a work into something of their own. How is a piece of music learned and prepared for performance? Stuart Hamilton has been Lois Marshall's accompanist for some years now, and I hoped he might reveal the mystery, at least insofar as it applies to Lois Marshall. He didn't, but what he had to say is nonetheless fascinating.
It's very interesting because Lois doesn't rehearse very much. When she tells me what her program is, I practice it. We get together maybe once before the program, and then we do it. And she's such an instinctive artist.
But intuitive.
Intuitive, that's the word I'm looking for, that it's made perfectly clear, and I'm sure anybody who has played for Lois, and many people have played for her, feel this, that she's one of the easiest people in the world to play for, because you know from the way she takes her breath how she's going to do a phrase. It's quite obvious, at least it was always obvious to me. We never had a discussion about tempo or, you know, for instance, a couple of times I would say to her, now, Lois, is this fast? How fast do you do this? And she said, oh, I don't know, let's do it, and then you'll find out. It was just a question that she knew what she wanted, and she made it clear, and it was as if she didn't want to waste what she had on a rehearsal hall. I never played anything for her that I didn't feel was just the way it should go, you know.
And learned with incredible quickness, I understand.
I don't know about that, because she always learned alone. I never played anything for her that she didn't know.
Unlike so many singers who come to their accompanists,
yes,
essentially to learn the music.
She plays the piano quite well. She's quite a solid pianist, and she studied quite a bit herself when she was a kid. And she's a very strong musician, too, very strong.
It's the strength of that musicianship of Lois Marshall's, to which Stuart Hamilton refers, that enables her to be an equally superb interpreter not only of the great German art songs, but also of the vocal masterpieces of the French repertoire, Debussy, Duparc, or Fauré. In contrast to the songs we've so far heard on today's program, here's Fauré's Chanson d'amour, where the nuance of the text and the delicate shading of the voice are perfectly adapted to the demands of the French song. The performance is from a concert in 1974 at the National Arts Center in Ottawa, and the pianist is Stuart Hamilton. Fauré's Chanson d'amour, Lois Marshall with Stuart Hamilton at the piano. You might be interested to know that that performance, taken from a 1974 concert at the National Arts Center, is available on a CBC recording, available from CBC Enterprises. On that same program is another Faure song, En Sourdine, and in talking about it, pianist Stuart Hamilton had some observations about the quality of the Marshall voice and her approach to a song.
It was a very interesting experience because I hadn't played that particular piece for her before, I don't think, in concert. And so it's a very, En Sourdine means muted, as you know, and it's a very muted piece, and it starts out with just a broken chord in the piano. And so I murmured through this, you see, and then Lois started, Carme, Donne de Mijou. It's a huge sound coming out of her, you see. Well, of course, I immediately had to bring up the volume of the accompaniment, because otherwise it was going to be a moment exquise on the piano with Wagner coming out of the lady. So I said to her afterwards, my goodness, Lois, I was so surprised, because it was amazing, because at the end of the song, the audience was absolutely gripped. It was so, the sensation of the piece was so still and quiet. She got the mood of the song in such an incredible way, but making an enormous amount of sound. So I said to her afterwards, I was so surprised, and she said, well, that's a big hall, you know. I had to sing for the people at the back of the hall as well as the people at the front. And that was always one of the marvelous things about Lois, was that she had a big voice. As a matter of fact, for the first few concerts that I did with her, I felt like I was holding onto a rocket. I remember for the very first concert, she opened with Nymphs and Shepherds of Purcell. And, you know, there's a very delicate little yum, da 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 da, bum bum bum, very delicate little piece. And so I was, you know, being as delicate as possible. And then she came out and she started to sing, and it was like the biggest Nymphs and Shepherds you ever heard. I don't mean that it was gargantuan or anything. It was just so full. Her feeling for the piece was so dainty, so incredibly dainty, but it was big dainty, if you know what I mean. And Lois was always, when I would listen to Lois in the hall, wherever I was, if I was at the back of the hall or something, I always had the feeling that she was right beside my ear when she was singing. It was one of the most amazing of her qualities, this fantastic projection she had.
It was about the time of the Ottawa concert we just sampled, the mid-1970s, that Lois Marshall was abandoning the designation soprano and officially becoming a mezzo-soprano. As we heard earlier today in the Songs of Defy and Brahms, she has always had a superb lower register, and the change of classification is more an accommodation of convention rather than an indication of any real vocal change, as Lois Marshall herself points out.
My voice was rather well developed in the lower part from many years back, and I didn't have to do anything unnatural. And I would love it if people would think of me as a singer rather than as, you know, I know we have to be put in categories, but I always think it's rather too bad.
Certainly, whether the program said soprano or mezzo-soprano, the quality of the singing didn't change, nor to any real extent did the repertoire, except perhaps that it continued to grow. Two of the great German song cycles, Dichterliebe of Schumann and Die Schöne Müllerin of Schubert, occupied prominent places in the more recent part of Lois Marshall's career. Dichterliebe, Poet's Love, contains a remarkable range of expression in its 16 songs, a range of expression easily traversed by Lois Marshall. Here are two songs from that cycle, totally different in their sentiment. The first is Ich hab in Traum geweinet, a desolate, muffled song. I wept as I dreamt you were in your grave. I woke with tears still on my cheek. By contrast, there is Die Rose, die Lille, the rose, the lily, the dove, the sun. I love them all, but now I love my girl, fine and pure. A song of delicate exuberance. This performance was given at Harthouse at the University of Toronto in 1978. The pianist is William Ade.
Die Trüge.
Two songs from Dichterliebe by Schumann, sung by Lois Marshall with William Aid at the piano. William Aid is one of a number of distinguished pianists who have been Miss Marshall's recital partners. Foremost among them, of course, was Weldon Kilburn, and in more recent years, Stuart Hamilton has most frequently played for her. But Lois Marshall has also given recitals with Gerald Moore, George van Renesse, Glenn Gould, Anton Cuerti, and Greta Krause. Mostly because Greta Krause devoted the greater part of her career to the harpsichord, her association with Lois Marshall in the song repertoire has been relatively limited, but there have been some outstanding collaborations by them, including Schubert's wonderful cycle Die Schöne Müllerin in 1979. Difficult as it is to isolate one song, I nevertheless asked Greta Krause if there was any one song in the set which especially exemplified some of the Marshall qualities.
Yes, I would say Ungeduld. Impatience, they say. Ungeduld is impatience, really.
Ungeduld, a relatively simple song in the set.
It's wonderful. I mean, the great thing is that there are four verses, either four or five,
yeah.
And what he does with them. And I don't think that you have to say anything. Anybody who hears it will immediately feel how impatient it is and how wonderful she drives to the last phrase when it is where it says "Dein ist mein Herz und soll es ewig, ewig bleiben." Yours is my heart and shall remain it forever. And how she builds it up in all the verses, it's each time different.
Ungeduld from Schubert's cycle Die Schöne Müllerin, The Beautiful Girl of the Mill, with Lois Marshall and Greta Krause. I should point out that this performance by Lois Marshall of Die Schöne Müllerin with Greta Krause has been recorded, along with Schubert's other great cycle, Die Winterreise, with Anton Cuerti at the piano. The complete album is available through CBC Enterprises. Die Schöne Müllerin, as well as the Schumann cycle, Dichterliebe, from which we heard excerpts just a few moments ago, are both pretty much the exclusive property of male singers on the grounds that they express a masculine sentiment. I asked Miss Marshall why she rejected the accepted notion that these songs express feelings appropriate only to men.
I think that they're more human feelings, though, don't you, than masculine or feminine. I probably would have done the big cycles more when I was younger, but people always said that a woman can't do these songs, and, well, they discouraged me, I suppose, from doing them.
You obviously changed your mind about that. Die Schöne Müllerin is always conventionally a man's song, but
yeah.
You sing them.
Well, I think, as I've said many times, I think that when a person is performing, you're an instrument, you are expressing the feelings of either a man or a woman. It shouldn't, the fact that you're a woman standing up there doing it shouldn't prevent you, I don't think, from singing these songs. So much of the repertoire reflects a man's thoughts. But I still think it's possible. If she's an artist, or if one is an artist, then you should have the capacity, surely, to be able to express these thoughts and feelings.
It's the expression and perhaps the narrative content that's important, not
yeah.
whether one is a man or a woman.
I don't believe so. I think that there are certain pieces that are built for a man, physically, for a man's voice. But any of the songs in these cycles are perfectly suited to a woman's voice, too.
In 1981, Greta Krause and Lois Marshall gave a recital of songs by Hugo Wolf at the Macmillan Theatre of the Faculty of Music in the University of Toronto. In a superb recital, there was one song in particular that stood out. Greta Krause.
The one that stands out the most is the last.
Abschied.
Which is, I think, a unique song, and what she did with it was just superb.
What happened to in Abschied? What makes it such a wonderful performance?
Well, it's a wonderful song. It's very, very witty. Murike, who wrote the poem, pokes fun at the critics, and Lois and I enjoyed that immensely.
She has a great sense of humor.
Lois had a terrific sense of humor. I can't begin to tell you how we enjoyed just working at this a little bit.
What is the song actually about? Can you tell us a little bit about what Abschied is about?
Yes, I can tell that easily. A young poet, there's a knock at the door of a young poet. In comes a critic. Looks at him and sort of is really quite, how shall I say, not aggressive. He says, you have a long nose, look at that, I've never seen that. Looks at him and the critic gets more and more upset and or furious at the idiot, and finally doesn't say very much, lets him talk, lets him say all the nonsense he has to say, and then finally he takes his candle in his hand to lead him to the door, to go, that's the Abschied, no, he goes, and when he's just at the door, there are steps leading down to the lower part of the house, he gives him a slight push, and that critic tumbles down the stairs, and all the poet says, in all my life, I've never seen anybody go down the steps that fast. And with this, Hugo Wolf breaks into a wonderful waltz. A waltz. Very funny one.
And the audience
loved
it.
The audience roared, yeah. Yeah, it's really very lovely.
Sie geben zu, dass das ein Ausflug ist.
Sheet by Hugo Wolf, sung by Lois Marshall with pianist Greta Kraus. That enthusiastic audience was at the Macmillan Theatre at the University of Toronto in 1981. In 1982, Lois Marshall made a last tour of Canada, literally from coast to coast. She now has time for a newfound hobby, painting, and for being chairperson of the Ontario March of Dimes. She's also artistic director for the Edmonton 1985 Bach Festival, and among all this new activity, there's still a little time for singing. For Lois Marshall is, before everything else, a singer, with the power to move her listeners as few people can. Her longtime accompanist, Weldon Kilburn, was with her for so many recitals, but even he was never able to resist the extraordinary effect of a Marshall performance, even when he was at the piano.
She is a remarkable talent, really. And, you know, with all the thousands of concerts that I've played with her over the years, I can remember, despite knowing her so well and hearing them so often, these songs, some of them, sometimes I couldn't even see the page, you know. It was a good thing I knew the music pretty well, because my eyes would be full of tears. She just, there was a remarkable quality there. Absolutely incredible.
How does this happen? Is Lois Marshall herself moved at her concerts in the same way we are?
I'll tell you what happens to me when I'm learning a piece. If there's something in the piece that makes me cry, and there often is, every time I come to a certain passage, I can't get through it. I just choke. And I have to sing it over and over and over again until I don't know, harden myself to it or something of that sort. Then, when I get out to sing it in public, that is gone, that feeling of losing control. Because if I lose control, then I'm saying nothing. But if I have my control, then I can express what I feel, and someone out there will get it. Maybe they'll cry, I don't know.
From the drama and sensitivity with which she treats a text, whether in an art song or an operatic aria, it should hardly be surprising that one of Lois Marshall's personal pleasures is in poetry, and what's more, in reciting poetry, which she does privately for her own pleasure, but which, for today, she's agreed to share. Here is Lois Marshall reading a few lines by A.E. Housman.
From far, from eve and morning, and yon 12-winded sky, the stuff of life to knit me blew hither. Here am I. Now, for for a breath I tarry, nor yet disperse apart. Take my hand quick and tell me, what have you in your heart? Speak now and I will answer. How shall I help you? Say, ere to the wind's 12 quarter, I take my endless way.
On this series, we've heard comments from many people about Lois Marshall. It's now only fitting that the final word should go to Lois Marshall herself.
I think of myself as a singer. I'm not a great intellectual, but I can sing, and I know that. And I don't know what it is, but there's something that I know I can do. And I think I'm just a singer. A Fond Kiss, arranged by Healy Willen, with pianist Weldon Kilburn, sung by Lois Marshall. This concludes this last of three programs celebrating the art of Lois Marshall.
Technical operation today was by Mike Furness. Neil Crory has been the producer for this series. I'm Carl Morey. We hope you've enjoyed these programs.